the vegetation add-on is one of the most popular commercial tools for Blender when it comes to adding realistic greenery to your 3D scenes. With a new version V6 just dropped, equipped with over 120 new plants on top of an already solid asset library, this could be a game changer if you're into rendering 3D nature, whether that's for art viz, concept art, animation or anything else. In this video, we're going to break down what the vegetation add-on can do. We'll look at how to use it, what's new in V6, and ultimately whether it can truly help you create photorealistic nature faster. A fun fact, one of my first jobs in 3D industry was actually rendering digital greenery, way back when I was working at a game development studio. So in a way, this feels like coming home. How do you install and use the vegetation add-on? It's pretty easy. You just drag and drop the zip file you downloaded from Superhive right onto the Blender's UI. It's always a good idea to confirm it's there in the Add-ons tab. This is also where you can select the folder for your assets and install the vegetation asset packs. Upon pulling out the toolbar on the right, you should find it under the B Production tab. And there it is. The UI is really simple. From here, you can just select different categories or just hit Alt to browse through a huge collection of trees, shrubs, pots, rocks and whatever. It's a pretty sizable library now with 120 extra assets in V6. Once you've selected the piece of vegetation you want to plant, you can change its season here. That will also affect the preview. And then just populate it in the center or at the 3D cursor position alternatively. And then you either append, which will add a unique editable version of the tree to your scene, or link, that will just reference that tree from the asset library, which is a great way to save space in your Blender file, but it also means that tree won't be editable. Now, even though the add-on technically supports both Eevee and cycles, it's really tailored for cycles, for photorealistic rendering. That's where you're going to get the best results. Each tree can be randomized. It will affect its orientation and some of its material settings. Then you click that button if you want to make that linked library asset editable. That is, for instance, if you want to go tab to enter the edit mode and delete all the leaves, which, by the way, are always preselected by default. Next, this button here snaps the object to the ground. And then in the animation tab, you can choose from a few presets, light breeze, medium wind, and so on. And of course, tweak the settings there to add a quick wind effect. One of the coolest things in the add-on, if you ask me. Light breeze mostly affecting the leaves, and then you can adjust its strength right here. Whenever you duplicate an asset, you'll need to hit the retarget animation button to make sure everything works correctly. You can change the seasons and other material properties at any time. To do that, select the leaf material, it's usually mostly about the leaves, and down there you'll find all the settings. To make it unique to that object, just create a new version of the material. And then you can change it into an autumn, a spring, or a winter variation. Actually, if there are flowers as well, you'll probably need to change those too. When you change the season, you might run into an issue. The leaves could start rendering as a solid black shader. And what it means, you don't have enough transparency bounces, which can be increased in the Light Paths panel. But actually, if you just want the leaves to be gone, a better way to handle that is to go into the edit mode, after making it editable first, if it's a linked asset. Tab, then X, and delete all the faces. The leaves are preselected by default. That should clear them right out. And the performance will be much smoother. Now, I've spent a couple of days testing different categories in vegetation, making test scenes and so on. We won't go through every single category out there, but I'll hit some of the highlights. Starting with rocks. Why rocks? Isn't this supposed to be about vegetation? I don't know, I have a soft spot for rocks. No pun intended. The rocks are pretty solid overall, just not really meant to be viewed close up. You can get away with it, but just don't expect a super duper detailed normal map to save the day. In more ambient lighting conditions though, I can totally see myself using them even for close-ups because the albedo map is really great. Alright, in vegetation all the measurements are real world, so everything from the rocks to the trees is scaled accordingly. For instance, by adding an ash tree for comparison, and maybe a human-sized box as well, which is gonna be 1.75 meters tall, and a bit thinner like that, you can see the rocks are actually pretty small, and the level of detail reflects that. They also don't have a bottom, which is to save on system resources, but that didn't stop me from rotating it like this though. So while these aren't the most versatile rocks in the universe, they are pretty good for medium and wide shots, especially if you throw in some fog and smoke and mirrors. One feature that really stands out about these rocks is the moss. It's pretty cool that you can change the amount of procedural moss and even guide where exactly do you want it to grow. And not only that, but also the overall darkness and even snow. Yeah, snow! Anyway, somehow that led me to moss, ferns and stumps and swamps. I thought, why not enhance it with some 3D moss from the Greenwall category? Boom, there it is. Pretty cool. I found out it's also pretty convenient to scatter around these green patches on the forest floor here and there, even though that's probably not its intended use. Anyway, I think it worked really well. In addition to the rocks, there are also stumps, some of them with leaves and stuff ready to be scattered around. Or placed by hand. Actually, I find it to be a pretty quick and enjoyable process anyway. Well, that looks like a middle finger. Anyway, these stumps are a nice touch. Always a plus. The ferns are something I always check out first. They are my favorite plant because they are very render efficient. They have big leaves, but not a lot of polygons, you know. Plus, they look different when you rotate them. They're just an easygoing plant. I love them. Randomization feature definitely helps with making each asset look slightly different, so I was able to build this scene in no time, really quickly. For the finishing touches, I explored the hanging plants section, whatever I could throw into the foreground, making it hang from above indeed, for that extra depth. What matters to me is that I really enjoyed the process of creating this scene using nothing but the vegetation assets, as I've said, in pretty much no time. Right off the bat, I want to address a big question. Does it work with G-Scatter and other scattering plugins for massive forest scenes and stuff like that? Yes, it does. Yeah, for instance, G-Scatter, that is a free scattering plugin by Grassworld. Here we have a patch of ground and two pretty detailed high-poly trees. I'll just open the G-Scatter panel, select this object as the emitter, and this green tree as the asset to be scattered, and boom, there we have it. If this is too heavy for your computer, you can click this icon to enable proxy preview mode and also tweak the viewport display percentage. These settings will only affect your viewport performance, not the final render. The proxy method can be changed to points that will make it run extremely fast, displaying our trees basically as a point cloud. Now we can do a lot of fun things with G-Scatter. For example, add a noise texture as an effect layer for the scale, then tweak its parameters to make the trees scale in some interesting pattern. Then, for instance, we can scatter some other tree, the yellow tree in this case, and apply an inverse of that mask, so each tree grows in its own little ecosystem. Or apply even funkier modifiers like proximity. Long story short, G-Scatter works perfectly alongside the vegetation assets for creating massive landscapes. Speaking of which, another scattering plugin, GeoScatter, supports the vegetation add-ons biomes, aka full natural scene recipes. Tropical, coniferous, deciduous, desert, that you can apply with just one click. It's worth noting that GeoScatter is also a paid add-on though, so if you just want to access the basic biome functionality, there's a free tool available called Biome Reader. As I've said, it's completely free and it's really easy to use. Once you have it installed, just add a plane, make it for instance 50 meters wide, as it all works in real-world units, then activate Biome Reader, select the emitter object, which is this plane. From there, just click Open Biomes, and if you've installed the Vegetation Scat Pack, I'll show what it is in a moment, you should see the Vegetation tab right there, with coniferous, deciduous, desert and tropical ecosystems. So you can select a biome that you like, this coniferous one for example, and just click to import. You'll get a security warning telling you the poly count might be getting high, but it's okay, we should be fine. And there you have it, that's a biome. All the layers are exposed right here in this tab. Trees, rocks, ferns, and so on. Pretty cool, right? If you want to add a different one, hit minus to clear it out. Then you can simply add another one, and it should just work. If Biome Reader doesn't see the vegetation scatter pack, go to its preferences, click install package, and point it to the scat pack file that came with the vegetation add-on. Then you should be able to see the vegetation folder right there. That being said, it should also be doable to create massive lush foliage covering whole shot by hand placing the trees. You can see the result on screen. I started with a nice sketchfab model and then just threw in a bunch of trees from the vegetation library. I was aiming to completely cover the screen with foliage, you know, to see how many trees I could add before my computer started to get sluggish, all while checking the quality of the trees, which by the way is totally on point. Category tree, then link the asset into the scene. Not append, but link. Otherwise the blend files would get huge. I randomly picked some trees that I liked. Some of them ended up being quite huge. I mean, the difference in size between some trees is actually enormous. To cover the ground level, there are many shrubs to choose from. I just duplicated a whole bunch of them. Then adding some backlighting made it all come alive by introducing a beautiful translucency. But what really took it to the next level was the wind, though. It's definitely one of the features that, for me, makes it stand out. It's so easy to add a wind effect, and it just works. And, what is important, Blender hasn't crashed a single time yet. Another major selling point of this add-on is the seasons, and it really is super easy to customize the assets in this way. It's just a matter of tweaking the season slider in the shader editor to effectively change the season. It's a lovely little feature for sure. Not some sort of a gimmick, that's what I want to say. I'll point it out again, going into a full winter mode exposes a lack of transparency bounces and cycles, I mean with the default settings, so you'll need to give it a boost. Taking it up to 30 helps, but it will also make the viewport a little bit slower. It's a bit of a trade-off. Let me know in the comments what your favorite season is. Oh, you can actually add some snow to the branches too. You'll find that in the trunk material for that final wintry look. Alright, and now I will go through some other pretty exciting asset categories really quickly. Shrubs! The selection of shrubs isn't massive, but the quality is great. And there is more than enough to choose from, especially with the randomization options in place. The shading controls make it easy to blend the plants into photoscanned environment base like that. And what's not to like? Ivy. Well, for making ivy, I usually prefer the procedural ways to model it, like the built-in ivy generator, even though it's showing the signs of age. Or let's say something like the Bagas ivy generator plugin. It's just way easier to make it grow right on the mesh, following the contours, obeying gravity, all that stuff. That being said, the climber assets, the ivy plants included with vegetation, are very usable, especially with some extra manipulation on our end to place it. If you want to use them, you'll have to make them editable first, then you can use the proportional falloff to nudge it into place, make it hang from above, whatever, conform to the mesh, and all that stuff. As I've said, it's just a little bit of extra effort on our side to adapt it to the geometry. The vine assets themselves are good quality though. My desire to test water lilies was mostly inspired by this shot from a city short called Impetus by William Landgren. You'll find the lilies, or more technically Nymphaeaceae plants, in the garden plant category. I think it took me just a few minutes to put together a nice watery scene like that, with a pond, some lilies and a few extra plants to recreate William's shot. There are a bunch of pretty amazing new succulents in V6. These scenes, by the way, were created by Renante Martinez. These are just great. The new decorative plants are just awesome for arch interiors. Then I actually tried poking around this scene from Foundations of Earth pack by James Kendi to enhance it with some plants from the desert category. It was fun and all, but then I realized the cacti shouldn't probably just stand on their own like that. You know, the whole environment in this case probably needs to be covered with some dried grass and weeds and whatnot. In hindsight, you know, that probably was a nice opportunity to use the desert biome coming with the add-on. With the help of the free biome reader, I mean. Yeah, anyway, I was just in a bit of an experimenting crunch, so I ditched this idea. But I tell you, the cactuses in the add-on are pretty nice anyway. By the way, is it cacti or cactuses? Now, I'm not a huge fan of fruit trees. My aesthetic usually leans towards more desolate, abandoned worlds with no room for peaches. But these are pretty nice. Using vegetation for arch viz and interior viz is probably the biggest use case for the add-on, so I tested this out by decorating an interior shot that I had put together some time ago. Starting with a green wall, which instantly set the right mood. Then actually there's a collection of pots to choose from. throwing in some decorative desert plants from V6, and also the new ornamental plants. These are just gorgeous for interior design. You know, the type of plants that you see in IKEA ads so often. Yet another demo seen by Reinante using the new ornamental plants. Thanks for sharing it. I thought of finishing my scene by adding a mossy tree trunk to the foreground, but I ended up using the photoscanned one from Polyhaven. It's hard to beat the detail. I think I've mentioned the V6 succulents before, but these guys are just a marvel of nature. That's it for covering the plants categories. Hopefully you now have a better sense of what the vegetation add-on has to offer and the variety of it and quality level you can expect. Now, how do you achieve some nice translucency and realistic shading of all this vegetation in Eevee? Well, by default, any vegetation looks a bit flat in Eevee compared to Cycles. To increase the shadow quality in Eevee, I'm going to crank up the steps and turn on ray tracing. That should instantly make the shadows a lot more realistic and a lot more similar to Cycles. Unfortunately though, the translucency rendering in Eevee just isn't on the same level of quality as in Cycles. So what we can do? Well, let's have a look at that nice little bonsai tree from the add-on. In Cycles, the light punches right through the leaves, lighting up their backsides. And in Eevee, it just looks flat. What we can do is fake that translucency bounce by adding some point lights and placing them right inside the leaves and turning the shadows off, then making the light radius a bit larger. And finally decreasing the custom distance and turning off soft falloff. That is our fake translucency bounce. Now we can just duplicate it a bunch of times with Shift-D. Feel free to use your artistic eye to place these lights inside the thick of the tree to make it look like the sunrays are scattering, making it glow. That's still not bad, but to make it look more like Cycles, what we can do is use the ambient occlusion pass in the compositor. For it to work, the viewport compositing should be turned on, then the ambient occlusion pass exposed for rendering, together with the environment pass. Feel free to pause the video and copy the compositor setup. It's the image pass mixed with the AO using the environment pass as a mask. And here's how it looks when it's mixed with the render. That gives it that self-shadowing effect, and you can set the distance right here, by the way. And that's what adds that final bit of realism and helps to ground our fake translucency effect and make it look semi-plausible. It's still not Cycles, but it's way, way better than what we had by default. I wonder if there's anything I missed. Maybe you'd like me to do a deeper dive into a particular scene we covered in this video? Let me know in the comments if that's something that you'd like to see covered. And just generally, let me know what you think of this video. I love hearing from you. Anyway, all the links for everything are in the description, including our affiliate link for vegetation. If you want to support us at no extra cost to you, you can get it through this link. That was Gleb Alexandrov for CreativeShrimp.com, bringing you all kinds of tutorials to help you express yourself with computer graphics.